Good afternoon, friends. A warm welcome to all of you present here today, especially to our young friends who have come from Orchid School. It gives me an immense pleasure to welcome amongst us India's well-known and best-selling woman author who needs no introduction, an author whose work has been read by most of us who have come here today. I won't go into the details of her profile. Ma'am doesn't want us to, want me to go into the details. So I won't go into the details. But before we begin, a special announcement. The last 20 minutes of our session is dedicated to the young students who have come here, especially to interact with their favorite author, Sudha Murthy. We welcome you, ma'am. And we would love to hear from you your journey into the world of books as a reader and as a writer.
Saglana namaskar. Ani lahan mulana ashirvad. It's always a pleasure to come back to Pune. Pune has its own place in my heart and in my brain both. Because we have an hour session, so let me not waste time. Get directly into the question that I come from a middle class family. My grandfather was a school teacher. My father was a college professor and a doctor. My mother was a school teacher. So I come from a middle class family where reading and writing were very important. Education was very important. Hence, writing or reading, it was nothing like I tried for it. I used to read a lot and started writing maybe at the age of 8 or 9, small stories, very small stories. I used to write good essays. And my mother would take me to some historical place and I'll come back and write what I felt about the monument. So that's the way how I started my journey of writing.
Ma'am, you are a multifaceted lady, having played many roles, and I'm sure there are many still under wraps. Which is your favorite role, and why?
Actually, this is not true, you know. I have a very simple principle in life that whatever role is given to me at that moment of time in life, I will do my level best. Let it be a teacher's role, let it be a social worker, whatever is that. Whatever role I have got, I would like to do it well. But writing is something very personal, you know, which is nothing to do with money, nothing to do with education, because I did computer science and nothing in, you know, writing doesn't require computer science. Writing is something which I love to express my emotions, and that's the reason I like writing. But by and large, anything is given to me, I would like to do my level best. That is my simple principle.
My next question actually is, how you developed your interest in writing, which you already mentioned that when you were young, you went with your mother to historical places. But that writing must be like a small essay or something. So how did you start your real full-fledged writing?
Well, when I was in a teenage, I'm sure all teenage girls will write, poetry I never wrote actually in my life. I never wrote poetry. Some essays of melancholy and all such things. But real writing I wrote when I was 29. I traveled on my backpack to America and with a very little money, some $300 or $400. And came back and I wrote my first travelogue, which was published in the form of a book. It was in Kannada. From Beyond Atlantic, my journey in America. You know, today when I read that, I feel very funny because going to America is like today is going to Bangalore to Pune flight, I feel. It's not difficult. But with minimum money and traveling in those days, it was something unusual. So it was my first travelogue. But my first novel came also in 1979-80, I wrote in Kannada, Atirikte, The Excess. which is translated, which is rewritten actually by me in English, that is Gently Falls Bakula. That is my first novel or my first full-fledged writing, I consider, in 79 or 80, which is 35 years back.
That is my favorite book. Okay, I just want to know, can everybody write? I mean, write in the sense, write a book? I mean, is it possible for anybody and everybody to just take a pen?
What is writing actually? Writing is a form of expression of your emotions. For example, any fine art is a kind of expression. What is dance? Dance is an expression. What is music? Music is an expression. For example, when Raag Mia Malhar you hear, then you feel that it's raining actually. It's an expression makes you to understand the meaning of the raag. Similarly, writing is an expression. And some people normally, it is not by training, I feel. This is my personal opinion. Like you take 10 courses on creative writing and 11th day you will be able to write. No, I don't believe in that. Writing requires few qualities. Number one, you should be very sensitive. Somebody asked me this question, why all the experiences happen only to you, Mrs. Murthy, why it doesn't happen to us? I said, no. All the experience happens to everybody. But people who are sensitive, they grasp. Like, you know, if there is a water spilt on the glass, and if there's a sponge, and you put a sponge, it takes water. You put a rubber doesn't take water. So people who are sensitive and who can absorb, they'll absorb the emotion and they express it in writing. So I assume that creative writing is something which requires a sensitivity. It requires certain discipline. For example, I have a Japanese bhabhi. She said, do you write every day 25 pages or 25 lines, like, you know, Japanese calculation? I said, no. It is not a machine calculation. I will write 500 page means divided by 365 days, every day one page and 1.5 page. It won't work that way, I told her. When I think over it and when I cannot keep it within myself, then I start writing it. It is like, you know, kanthavarman tatnatasa, yoda pariyant. When the emotions come up to here, then I start writing it. And once I write and complete that book, then I feel empty. For example, House of Cards, that I wrote in Kannada, what I have called that, Paridhi. In Marathi, it has come as a Pariha. That novel, idea was with me for 15 years. 15 years, because I was thinking about it all the time. Though I may be talking, everything is always germinated in my mind. After 15 years, I decided, okay, now I'm going to write. It took 45 days for me to write. After that, next 5 days, I was not able even to get up because I was so tired mentally. So I have my method of writing. And you should be sensitive. You should have discipline. You should be very honest to your characters. That is what I do. If I don't have that experience, until I get that experience, I don't write. You know, suppose somebody goes, you know, for example, I wrote Mahashweta, a book on leukoderma. For that 2 months, I sat in a specialist hospital to see what a patient feels, how a doctor tells, how what exactly is that really means to a patient. So to get that kind of experience, I work hard, and because I should be honest to my characters, and that takes time. And once it is done, then I'll write. So I have kept these two things in my mind. If number one, I should be very honest to the character. For that, whatever is required, I should work for it. Number two, you should be sensitive for every emotion around you. Then you'll be able to write.
And also maybe observation.
Yeah, sensitivity and observation both are required. Otherwise, if you're insensitive, nothing you can write. If you're not observing, nothing you can write. Because everything is normal for you. There is no change.
Do you think there is any relationship between knowing a particular language and writing in that particular language? I mean, I read somewhere that you always write in Kannada and then it is translated to English or other languages.
I have a very peculiar way. I know 5 to 6 languages fairly, I can converse. For example, Marathi, I can converse, but I can't write in Marathi. Conversation is, you will learn it within 2-3 months or 5 months or 6 months. You have to think in that language. You have to think in that language. For example, every novel of mine, I write in Kannada because I think in Kannada, which is my mother tongue. But every experience or the every column in the paper which I write, and later I have made my columns book only, that I think in English. So when I write in Kannada, I write with a pen and a paper and a shorthand in Kannada. I write it and keep it for 6 months. I don't do anything, and after 6 months, I will rewrite it again. Whereas in English, I sit on the computer and I write 3 columns in a day. So I have kept 2 compartments. Where I want to be very precise because my columns will go in the paper where I know 1,000 words, okay, 700 words. I have the limitation there. In 750 words, I should complete my emotions or experience. So I should choose the correct word and exact up to the whatever is required for that article. So that time I think in English and I write in English. And any emotional novel, I think in Kannada, my mother tongue. And for many emotions, I can substitute a single word because it's my mother tongue. And that time I realized the importance of mother tongue. Mother tongue is the one where you can think in that language and express that in that language. And for many words, you should have one word to express that. So that is my definition of mother tongue. And so Kannada, my novels will be written in Kannada. Then I don't take any translator's help because I know what are my plus and minus, so I will rewrite that, the same novel in English. And for my columns, first I write in English, then I'll rewrite in Kannada. So that is the both way I do that myself.
So your emotional writings are in Kannada and your professional writings are
in English. That's true. To be very precise.
Okay. So what preparations are needed to become a good writer or a writer for that matter?
I think just now I told you should observe, you should be sensitive, and you should be honest to your character, the same
thing. Yeah, but writing all these things, okay, you collect all the information by doing, by observing, by being sensitive. But how do you put it in words, you know, on the paper?
It's, you know, once I attended a creative writing course just to see, they say, okay, you should imagine. But none of them work for me, you know. I can tell my experience. It may look very funny, but I truly believe it's a gift. It is like I'm a scriber. The real writer is the goddess Saraswati, I feel. I'm not. I'm only a scriber. Otherwise, I do not know why do I write the same way. If you tell me after 10 minutes, I may not be able to write the same way. So I feel it is something with the...
It's a gift of God.
Maybe a goddess Saraswati, no one else. It's only she. She comes and I write. And that is the reason even when I had less money, whatever royalty I took, I never used it for myself. Because I felt it is not mine. You know, it belongs to her. It is Saraswati's money. How can I take it? So all my royalty goes to a charity. Even when I had less money, I never used it. With that money, I bought a sari. With that money, I made a bangle. Nothing I made. Because it is not my money. I always felt it is her money. I should give some money.
How many languages do you speak, read, write?
Read, write, and that is okay. Like Marathi, I can read. Very slowly, I can read. I can write with little bit of mistakes. I can speak maybe a Kolhapuri kind of Marathi I speak because I'm not a Puneri, you know. I studied in Kolhapur when I was very young, so I have more Kolhapuri chap, I think, than Puneri chap. Pailwan Marathi then call. But 1 minute, but with all those things, Kolhapur people are very large hearted and very fond of good food. Hospitality, jangi kusti, a natak, tamasha, all this is Kolhapur's life, you know. I can manage, of course, Kannada I know very well. Kannada, English, Marathi I will manage. Konkani I understand 100% and may be able to manage to some extent. Telugu I understand 100%, able to do little bit of Telugu. Tamil I understand, Gujarati I understand 100%, Bengali I understand 100%. Urdu I can manage to some extent. Hindi I manage reading and writing. Oriya I understand 100%, but I can't speak. The reason is I work in these areas, you know. I work in Orissa, I work in Telangana or what is that? Andhra Pradesh. I work in Tamil Nadu. So when I work, you know, people talk to me. I tell them, you talk in your language, I'll reply in my language. But hard, you know, I manage with that. So, and I've written a book on, you know, one article on that people do not know I understand Oriya very well. And there are many people who comment on me and I understand that, you know. I have written that they were making, they are saying that lady has a gray hair but no brain inside and all of those things. And she did not know I was understanding that.
The day I stopped drinking milk. Yeah. You've mentioned this.
But she did not know that I can follow, you know. That's okay.
How has your writing evolved so far? Has the style, content and substance changed with time?
Of course it has changed. It has grown. So, suppose you tell me to write some novels today, I write in a different way. I think because I think in a different way. When you are young, you think different with experience, with lots of ups and downs in life. You start thinking in a different way. Your philosophy change. If I have to write a Gently False Bakula today, I will write in a different way. Because I look life in a different angle. So a good writer is the one who uses his or her experience and evolves. And that is very important for a writer to have experience and evolve. One should not remain in the same place because your attitude towards life, your attitude towards money, all those things change over a period of time. And to some extent, I will tell in my case, not only my experience writing, which has affected my writing, my social work has affected a lot more in my personal life because I'm one person who has seen maximum poverty in this room than anyone else. I have seen a place, I have gone to a place where a woman was naked, she could not come out because she had no sari. You know, I wanted to give her a sari, I said, you come out, I'll give you a sari. She said, no, I can't come out. I said, what's the matter? She said, Amma, you are a woman, but still in front of you when I want to come, I don't have a sari to wear. That kind of poverty I have seen. I have seen where children were sold for 5,000 rupees. I have seen that. It was very pathetic. I also met, you know, many politicians, many film actresses, many VIP people, all those. So my canvas has become very large. And that has affected my writing as well in a good way. That's all is life. I've seen many deaths, like my mother-in-law and my mother, both of them died in my hand only, in 15 days difference. That time I realized, what is death? Death is, it's eternal. It's real. And for what we fight in life, for what? Because you really don't carry anything. And it really affected me a lot more in writing. And I worked in tsunami for 3 months. I've seen a lot of dead bodies all around. And between I'm standing there, you know, making, okay, which are the children dead bodies, make it separate. That kind of a thing I have seen. I worked in drought where people crave for one glass of water. And we here take 10 buckets of, you know, the shower. I never use the shower. I say somebody will be deprived of water, one bucket of water. I worked with the war widows where the only son has died. Only son has died, you know. And his wife is pregnant. I have seen only son has died, not yet married. I have seen a woman with 5 children, husband dying, you know, in Kargil war, all those things. So these are all, they have taught me a lot in life. We unnecessarily fight. We unnecessarily think we are very good looking. We are very intelligent. We are very rich. If you are rich, there's always a Bill Gates above you. You are very good looking, Aishwarya Rai is there. Okay, you are very intelligent, okay, Manjul Bhargav is there. So in life, there are always people above you, below you. You should always remember, when you are in difficulties, look at the people below you and get strength from them and try to lead a normal life. So all these experiences have affected my writing. And during writing, I went on changing. I remember, you know, for me, before foundation, India was a land with 32 states, 14 or 15 language, many dialects, 150 kilometers. If you travel anywhere in India, the culture changes, the language changes, food habits change. All these statistics, you know, GDP, etc. But after working with foundation, I realized what India means. India means not software. India does not mean Bollywood. India means there is an unknown poverty line and people are below that. And it's our duty to help as much as possible. And that is my India. In my India, If somebody gets 3 sets of clothes and 2 meals a day and good education, including English, at the up to the class level 10th, then I'm very happy. Then GDP and or I don't even bother.
What are the challenges involved in writing for young readers vis-a-vis an adult reader?
Actually, adult writing is very easy. Writing for children is very difficult. For following reason, number one, you should be very careful about the words what you use, because their mind is like a wet wall and your writing is like a glass piece. On a wet wall, you write whatever in the glass piece. It becomes eternal. So you should never use a wrong word. You should never convey, though I won't give any moral lessons, but end of my every story, there'll be a moral lesson. It's hidden. I don't make it explicit, because imagine if I always tell, you should tell truth, you should be honest, then you think it's a moral class and you don't even read my book. But if I tell you, look, you know, if you don't work hard, what happens? I think people must have read, children must have read my salty story or something I have written on the girl who was very lazy. Salty Sambar, I think, I won't remember now. Salty Sambar, the story of, that's my own story actually. That's my own story. When I was very young, I used to read a lot and never do any household work. Even now I don't do much. But that time I won't even do that. So once my mother was preparing sambar and she told me, there was a picnic day, she said, you are carrying sambar for your class. I said, yes, Amma, you prepare very well, so I'll take it. But she told me, look, I'm going somewhere and sambar is about to ready and you put this much salt. She kept the salt and told me, you have to put this salt. And I forgot. I did add the salt, but I forgot to tell that. I went somewhere, then my father thought this girl anyway doesn't do. He put the salt, grandmother put the salt, and my mother came back. Anyway, she won't listen to me, so she put additional salt. So it became a salty sambar, and then my mother told me, at the end, nobody ate, and I told my mother, oh, it is not good. She told me, beta, you it's good that you read a lot, you are engrossed, but you also have a responsibility. When a work is given to you, you should complete it very well. If you don't do, your life will be like a salty sambar. Nobody will believe you. Oh, anyway, she doesn't do, they say. So all these examples are converted into a story where telling children, look, if you don't do, the results will be like this. And that's the reason writing for children requires more time, more thinking, and correct message we should convey, because it's very easy to make them, you know, greedy, make them unhappy, tell them, look, this is the way to live, lie, and but it will, you have a lot of advantage. Don't do that, because after all, we are all setting suns. They are the morning sun. For them, we should give them water, manure, and shade if it is required, or sun rays they require, and they should grow up. And it's our duty to give them a very good children book so that they should get a strength by reading that. I consider that is difficult. There's a very funny thing. I have two granddaughters, Krishna and Anushka, and both of them cannot read. But they know that I write for children. So one book I have dedicated to Krishna, that is Grandma's Bags of Stories, I suppose. So I told Krishna, when you grow up, you have to read this book. It's for you. The other one felt very bad that I have not written for her. One is 4, other one is 2. So they said, okay. And I always told them, you know, in life you have to share. Everything in life you have to share. Sharing is caring, because it's very important in life. If you care for someone, then that means you share. They said, yes, Ajji, we'll share. They made the book into 2 parts and shared.
Now a little diversion. Today the electronic medium is the most popular with all ages. The successful Marathi film Pitru Run is based on your story, Runa. We also had a TV serial made on your very famous book, Dollar Bahu. So do you have any plans to exclusively write scripts for movies or teleserials in future?
Actually, one can write. It is not difficult at all. It's not difficult. One can write. But I really do not have time. I don't have that kind of time. Because writing is the result of my experience. My main food is foundation. And writing is a pickle, actually. You can't eat pickle all the time. And I don't have that kind of a time to sit down, because whatever I do, I would like to do well. Rewrite, because script and all, you have to go many versions in that, 0-1, 0-2 version. So that's the reason I'm not, though I got many offers to write, I've not taken it seriously.
We have read that you are a big movie buff. So can you highlight something on those lines?
I always loved movies from as a kid, I used to love. It was, you know, in those days, I'm 65 now, imagine 60 years back. Going for a movie was a taboo. No, you can't see a movie. And in our village, it used to come only 3 months in a year, Tambu Theater. Okay. And I've seen Marathi movies actually, because in those days, Karnataka was not, North Karnataka was not separated from Maharashtra. So until 1956, it was not separated. So there are a lot more cultural exchange in those days. And I remember I have seen Shamchi Aayi. And I also remember there is a song in that. Draupati Che Bandhu Shobhe Narayana. I think you can, people who are my age can understand. And people who are not my age, please go on YouTube and see that clip. Draupati Che Bandhu Shobhe Narayana. Beautiful song of love between Draupadi and Krishna as a brother and sister. So it was rationed, and it was rationed more. So I liked it, I have to see more. And it is not just a movie for me. Movie is not seeing a movie for 3 hours for me. It is much more than that, because I see a movie, I'll come back and I write my comments. How was the editing? What are the sahitya? What is the music score in that? Then the heart of any movie, the story. If the story was up to the mark or not. It is my own way. I told if I would not have been in software, if I would not have been writing, or maybe social work, I would have been a movie journalist, definitely, like Anupama Chopra. Because I see every movie with a purpose, and I make my own comments on that, which is good, which is not good. My rating is much difficult than your paper rating, you know. And I see different language movies. Marathi I see. Off late Marathi movies are really very good, off late. And Kannada, yes, I see. Telugu I see, because they are better movies. I don't have any bias. Tamil I see. Hindi though, all the time I see. Sometimes I see English movies. Bengali movies, I see. Gujarati movies are not great, I felt it. The dramas are better. So I'm very serious movie goer. I have 500 CDs at home, and probably every day I have to see half an hour, some movie, one or another I have to see. I enjoy. And because I'm also a writer, I said I wish they could have written a dialogue this way better and all those things.
So you also acted in a movie.
That is, the producer was my friend. Director was my friend. He told me you have to act. I said, look, if you give me very expensive sari, wear it and color my hair and all, I don't look like myself, you know. So whatever dress code I have, in that you give me a role, I don't mind, even 5-10 minutes or something. Then the best role was judge, where you don't have to speak at all, okay?
So are you open for any more roles in movies?
No.
Or on television? No.
It takes a lot of time, and it's not my field. You know, you have to, anything is vidya, you know, anything is education. Anything, you have to put an effort. If you have to act, then you should know what is the acting, you have to work on it, you have to see which is the correct dialogue delivery, etc. It requires a lot of time, and I really don't have that kind. And I don't want to do that.
Okay. In your book, How I Taught My Grandmother to Read and Other Stories, you've written a few anecdotes on our favorite teacher, the late President Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. We would like you to say something about.
I met Abdul Kalam in his 68th or 69th birthday. I still remember. That time he was not president. You know, he was head of the DRDL or DRO or something. Actually, I have written about that in my book also, because one day I got a call from Delhi saying that Mr. Abdul Kalam wants to speak to you. I told her it's the wrong number. Because I don't have anything with Abdul Kalam, you know. And I met him, I knew he was a big scientist, Bharat Ratna, that much I knew, but what is there between me and him to talk? So I told, oh, there's a mistake, operator, I told him, it may be for Narayan Murthy. So instead of Mr. Murthy, I connected to Mrs. Murthy. He said, no, he specifically said Mrs. Murthy. Then I was worried, you know, what have I done to Abdul Kalam is talking. He said, I read your column in what paper? I don't remember now. Tamil magazine, Kalki or something somewhere. Or maybe English, Week magazine. No, he wrote IT Divide. IT Divide was the article I wrote for the Week. I used to write columns for five papers simultaneously in those days. So he said, I really like the ending. I said, how IT has divided the society. The shopkeeper, I went to the shop to buy something. And looking at me, he said, it will cost 100 rupees a dozen or something, mango. My student, who was a software engineer in my own company, she came and she asked me, ma'am, how come you are here? And while I was talking to her, then he told, mangoes will cost 200. And she paid and she took. I said, just now you told me 100 and why it's 200 for her? He said, you're a school teacher, you don't understand. She is an IT person, and she works in a big company, Infosys, for that, 200 rupees. You are... And you are a school teacher because she called me, ma'am, how come you are here? There is an examination time. A teacher, so for you it's 100. And I said, my God. Then I realized for IT company people, they have different rates, including house rent, mangoes, all these market. Then I wrote on that, how IT, a common man divides IT person is four times more. And that Abdul Kalam read that and he called me, said, I really laughed. And this is a fantastic... column, and I read your column every time when it comes. Then he said, your Tamil is very good. I said, no sir, my translator is very good. Okay, that's the way how I knew him, and he will call me when the column is very good. At 68th birthday, I think, that's about 16 years back, he came to Bangalore and he told the organizer that I want 15 minutes free time because I have invited Mrs. Murthy. I only talk to her all the time on telephone, but I have not met her. So I met him in a triple ITB convocation, and he said he was concerned about students and he was asking, what do I do for... I was teaching computer science at that time. So we talked about it and he was very enthusiastic about, conveying the right things to youngsters, etc. Then he said, keep in touch, and I used to talk to him on a regular basis. Then, once I decided I'll go to Rameshwaram, and he said, I will join because his brother stays. And that day they announced he will become president. And then I said, no, sir, please don't come. Now you are president. Four or five of us were going to Rameshwaram. Then I went and stayed in his house. I know their family. And they speak to me in Tamil and I talk to them in Kannada, actually. That's the way how things work with them. And they're very, very, very nice people. Very simple people, actually. That's the way how my friendship with their family started. And when he became president, I called him to inaugurate a children's hospital which you have built for poor people in Orissa. He said, what have you done for Bihar? I said, no, we have not done much for Bihar because for me, going to Bihar is hard. Our security doesn't allow, our Infosys security doesn't allow. They think it's one-way ticket for me. So he said, no, you should do something for Bihar. And as a president, when I'm going, I will send you an invitation. You should come and see Bihar. And that's the way how I toured Bihar with him. And then we started working in Bihar. And I have great regard for him, for his family, for his people. I have attended all their weddings in the family. And so, his family, we are family friends. And I feel, he was like a Bhishma, never married. Ichha Marani, led a simple life. What else do you expect?
And he passed away with his favorite students. He was with the students.
Yeah, that is true. So I told like a Bhishma. Whenever Bhishma wanted to die, he died. Same way he died.
You are a role model and an example that has not limited her writing to just publishing of her books. But you have extended it to social causes. You have donated more than 50,000 books to libraries across rural areas, and you have taken a lot of effort to spread the love of books and reading. Tell us something about it.
In Karnataka alone, we have done 60,000 libraries, not books. 60,000 libraries. Each library will have 3,000 to 5,000 books. I think I have written even that in my article. Give books to at least one library. In one of my books, my grandfather was a school teacher, and we were in a village. He used to take me to library every day because he had a friend there, and I started reading in a very young age. I finished all the books and I really got bored. Once we were coming back from library, he told me, that's the way how I used to converse with my grandfather. He will do half the poem and remaining half I should complete it. He said, a poetry, you know, a poem, if I have wings, what will I do? The real poetry is, I will go to Buckingham Palace and greet the queen. I will go and find the treasures in the land, etc. I told I will go to the next village library and read other books. So my grandfather felt very funny answer, and in the night he called me. He said, look, he never went out of Karnataka. No, he studied in Deccan College, Pune. Pune and Karnataka, he never went out of that. After all, a simple school teacher, high school teacher. He said, in my life, I have not gone out of Karnataka other than Pune. And I read a story, he told me, about Carnegie Mellon. There was a law, Carnegie was a great businessman in America 100 years back. And he had $1 billion in those days, maybe. Today, maybe $100 billion, maybe. Whatever he wanted to give to his children, and then remaining money, he said, this will go to build a library in every village in America. You go to any village in America, today if you see a public library building, it's a Carnegie's building. In order to honor him, they called the Computer Science University as Carnegie Mellon University, but it's basically a Carnegie's contribution is building a free library to everyone in America. This story my grandfather read somewhere. There was no internet in those days and all those things, but he must have read. He said, I don't know when you grow big in life, how much money you will get. Because in a teacher's house, the question of money is never discussed, you know. What degree you will get, what, you know. They were all salaried people. We never talked about money. Okay, your beta, your next birthday will be in Taj, Vivanta. And for a holiday, you'll go to Singapore and all such things were not existing. Today the holiday, today is your birthday, okay, fine. Shubham Karoti, they will tell, or Shatamanam Bhavati, the Ashirvad will be there, okay, do your job next. More than that, we never had actually. To some extent, I feel that is in a way good because China is going to ban birthdays. Until you are 70 years, you can't celebrate your birthday. And after 70, if you are alive, then you celebrate. So ours is a very simple way of living. So he said, when you grow big, you know, if you make good money, this is my desire that you should donate books to at least one library. Because, you know, I realized you love books so much. And will you promise me? He asked my hand. I was 12 years old. He was 62 years old. He was 62 years old. I was 12 years old. And I put my hand on his hand was rough. It was cold in the summer, in the winter. The hand used many chalk piece and taught many students, and mine was a tender hand. And he told me, this is my promise, will you promise me? I said, okay, I will give books at least one library. And later he said, I won't be alive to see that, and he died. He was 74. I was 12, grandmother was 62, that's the way I remember. He was 74 and he died. When he was 90, he died, and when I became successful in the eyes of the world, made money, the first thing, you know, somewhere I remembered, if you make good money, what is the definition of a good money? It's very difficult. For example, if you have 5 gold bangles, when you make good money, then you require 10 gold bangles. If you have one car, when you make good money, you require another car. Because this is a greed. Greed and good money are different, you know. Good money means what is you require for your sake to live is good money. Rest is not your money. This is my way of looking at it. That is my way of, it may be wrong, but that's the way I have lived. I said, what will I do with this money? Then I remember the Kathopanishad, it says, Danam Priyavaksahitam, Shraddhahi Danam, Ashraddhahi Nadanam. If you don't have Shraddha in giving away, don't give away. So I said, I have to do Dana because Dana is very essential in life. Suddenly I remembered my grandfather that when you have enough money, you should do a library. So I built a library in his name in my village. And then I said, okay, let me start giving books. So up to this day, we have given more than 60,000 library books. And probably that is one way of thanking my grandfather, who gave me very good values in life, who taught me what it means to be simple in life, what a joy it is there in simplicity, and not to tell lie. Normally, I don't lie. Normally, I don't lie, except a white lie like, just now I had milk and all, you have seen. Normally, I don't lie because I don't have great memory power to remember what lie I told last time. You have to remember, no, last time, what did I lie? Why have all those things? Tell truth and truth alone. And live as simple as possible, which our ancestors have taught. You have to live in a simple way. And you should have a soft heart and a strong hand, which is told in Mahabharata. Natvahe kamaye rajyam, nasvargam napunarbhavam, kamaye dukkha taptanam, praninam artinashinam. I don't want rebirth, I don't want kingdom, I don't want beauty, I don't want anything in life. Oh God, if you really want to give me anything, give me this soft heart and this strong hand so that I can wipe the tears of others. Not other way, a strong heart and a soft hand. No, it's other way. A soft heart and a strong hand so that I can wipe the tears. These are the fundamental values my grandfather taught me. And that time I never realized what he taught, but it became very important to me later part of my life. Maybe that is a gratitude I expressed to my grandfather in the form of library, I suppose.
I'm sure we have a lot of aspiring authors sitting here amongst us. They would definitely like to carry with them a few pearls of wisdom from you as an author. Any specific thoughts that you would like to share with them?
I will tell them, if you feel like writing, please write. Don't think I will write and I'll publish, I'll make money, nothing of that. Writing and making money is a different world, okay? You feel like expressing your emotions, write. Okay, and keep it for some time. Read after 3 months and see, is it okay? Use the correct words. Be honest, whatever you write. And then, you know, if you want to make it as a career, then, you know, you should go on writing. You know, write, practice makes a man perfect. Over a period of time, you'll become perfect. One day, you don't become a great writer. It takes some time. Only Shakespeare and all this must have been God's gift. So they are different. People like us, over a period of time, you'll become perfect. Start writing, even today. And you don't have to show it to everybody. Write and keep it inside. And then you open it and read after 1 year, 2 years, how you have changed. And don't say at 55 I'll start. Write at the age of 10, 12, 14, 15, whatever is there. Whatever you feel like writing. Don't feel shy, somebody will read, okay? And don't be under the impression what you write, it has to be published. Not necessary. But if it is really good, you know, then it comes out. But make writing as a habit. In olden days, they used to write diary. Actually, it was a very useful method. Today, there's not even a letter, forget about diary. SMS, with no grammar, SMS is very popular. So please don't write in SMS language, okay? Write in your own language. Let it be in Marathi or Hindi or in English, whichever your mind thinks. Be honest to your mind. Don't push the mind. Oh, my mother tongue is Marathi. I have to write in Marathi. My mother tongue is in Hindi. I have to write. Don't push the mind. Whatever your mind thinks, in whatever language, please write. And keep it for some time. If you are a teenager, don't publish until you are 20 plus. Because your ideas change so much after that. Okay? Write it. And, you know, and enjoy writing it. You know, it's not, oh, I have to write every day. If you feel like writing and enjoying it, then you write and keep it for some time. And then after, two, 3 years, you bring it, make a collection. Then you give, you know, you give it to a paper in a column or something that way. Start now a very simple way. You know, like writing a column is the best way to write, actually, I feel. Because, you know, you have a limitation of the words that puts your intelligence into a test. And also, you know what exactly you're trying to write. Don't go on describing too much because nobody, they'll skip the pay, you know, they will skip the paras. I always say people who have paid my, for my book, it's 200 rupees or something. My books are not expensive because I always still reduce my royalty, but doesn't matter, but don't make my books expensive. 200, 250 rupees. So when I take, when somebody pays for my book 200 rupees, I should be honest to you. I, you know, like, you know, if there are many techniques in writing. If I want to fill the pages, then let me go to a conversation mode. What did you say? What did I hear? Okay, did you say this way? So you can fill the page. But what is the outcome of that? Zero. You know, you don't get anything. When someone pays 250 rupees for my book, they should take something from this book. So don't cheat these readers by writing in a conversation mode. Don't write too much of description. Nobody will read. Nobody will read. Just skip the page, next page. Okay? Write relevant, exact, what is needed. And read many books. When you read great books, you understand how little you know. You know, read good books. Reading is a great habit, actually. And the best habit. Read more books, then you will correct yourself. Okay, that book was very good. Why was it good? Because they gave the following information. Suppose a similar kind of situation is there, what do I do? But don't copy anybody. Make your own signature. Make your own signature. Doesn't matter. Somebody is great, fine. You run your marathon. You don't have to run somebody else's marathon. You have to write your own marathon.
If you had to choose, which writer would be, would you consider as your mentor?
No one. No one. I have enjoyed people's writing. For example, I have enjoyed a lot of Sanskrit literature. I used to, when I was young, I used to speak Sanskrit actually. Later I lost because there was nobody to talk. My grandfather taught me Sanskrit fairly well, and I have read the original of Raghuvamsa, Sapnavasavadatta, all Kalidasa's work I have read, original. And I always was fascinated by Kalidasa when I was a teenager, maybe because of the romance, because of the seasons he described, beautiful, you know, nobody can describe like him romance or rainy season the way he does. No one can do that. Later I started reading in Kannada, Shivaram Karant, S.L. Bhairappa and many more people. Then I started reading English. English, I prefer to read English authors than American authors. I always like English authors because still I feel it is their mother tongue. I do not know. I always liked reading their books. But nobody is a mentor, nothing like that. This is a creative art. There is no mentor, nothing. You yourself is a mentor for this. Atmahi atmano bandhur, atmahi ripo atmana.
I think I will now take, I'll ask the students to come out with their questions. And before I do that, I request the youngest admirer of Sudha Murthy, Sanchita.
Let me see my
book. She would like to read a few lines from from her favorite book.
Yeah? Let me see her properly.
I love reading books by Mrs. Sudha Murthy. Last year, my didi had given me the first copy during the summer vacation, and now my mom has got me the others. My favorite book is How I Taught My Grandmother to Read and Other Stories. I read many of these stories over and over again. I like them because there are stories of real people, and there was so much to learn from their experiences. For example, when Avva was willing to learn how to read, even though she was quite old, and now I will read one passage from that story.
Beta, you come here on this stage. Everybody will see you. Come, come. Come. Come here and sit next to me and read. Unlike my granddaughters, okay? Come.
Sanchita.
You are from which school?
Vidya Valley.
You have to tell the school. Who is your teacher? You have to tell the teacher's name.
Pallavi ma.
Now you read.
Avva, at this age of 62, you want to learn alphabet. Your hair is grey, your hands are wrinkled, you wear spectacles, you work so much in the kitchen. Childlessly, I made fun of the old lady, but she just smiled. For a good cause, if you are determined, you can overcome any obstacle. I will work harder than anyone, but I will do it. For learning, there is no age bar. My other favorite story in this book is Doing What You Like is Freedom. It's about two boys, Puneet and Sharad, who are about to start college. Puneet is a very pampered and protected boy, and Sharad is very independent. Sharad feels like he's a tree in the forest. In contrast, it makes Puneet appear as a stunted bonsai plant. I would like to thank Mrs. Sudha Murthy for sharing so many interesting and meaningful stories for us children to learn from. Thank you.
A big hand for Sanchita. Thank you, Sanchita. Okay, where are the kids from Orchid School? Please put up your hands and ask questions.
Children,
okay, stand up. What's your name?
I have a small request. Don't praise me, it's a waste of time. Ask directly the question. Okay, and don't get scared what mummy will say, what teacher will say. Whatever you feel like asking, please ask. And don't praise me, just ask questions.
My name is Priyal. I'm from the Orchid School, and my class teacher's name is Bindudi.
You don't remember?
No, I do. My question is, what are your views on modern literature? Like the books we read, basically, like maybe The Hunger Games or Divergent, books like that.
There's nothing wrong in the modern literature, because literature is ever-flowing river. There will be old river, there's the old water, there's the new water, but water is water. Literature is literature, because every literature is the function of that time, okay, that time, that society. So modern literature is as good as this literature. There's no difference for me.
And one more question.
No, one question per person. Because there are the other kids, no, they would like to ask. Yes, beta.
My name is Durga. I'm from the Orchid.
You don't look like that.
Well. My class teacher's name is Amarjiddi. I wanted to ask that, do you write in your spare time, or do you just like to write, or do you have a special routine? Like you spend time for writing and...
No, I understood your question. I do write in the morning. Please sit down. When I feel like writing, I don't have the luxury of taking 2 months off and sit and write in a quiet place. Please sit down. You know, some people have that luxury. If they want to write, then they will go to a quiet place, a farmhouse, sit down, close all the doors, and listen. No, that is actually. In writing, any disturbance really affects, you know, any bell rings, everything really affects you. So I don't have that luxury, because I have my work, which I just cannot leave. So I have to be in my office at 7:30, 8 in the morning. So I get up at 4:30 and write up to 1 hour before my office I stop, because I have to come out of that and then become normal. It's very hard for me, but 4:30 in the morning, 4:30 to 6:30, up to 7 I do, and then I do my routine work. Still it will be in my mind, but I'll go to office, do everything, come back, and rarely if I get time in the night, I'll continue. Otherwise, early morning I write. There is no... I would love to have that kind of a situation where nobody, you know, like I don't feel like eating at that time, I don't feel like talking to people at that time, but I can't afford. Given a chance, if nobody disturbs me, I want to sit in a room, and for 3 days or 4 days I can finish a novel. But I don't get that kind of a quiet time and a place where nobody visits me. It won't happen to me. Okay. Yes, beta. Next year.
My name is Ishita. I'm from Vipkyo High. And my teacher's name is Soumya, ma'am. I have written a book at the age of 8. And ma'am, I would request you if I can come up on stage, take your blessings and gift one copy of my book to you.
Come. Thank you.
Diary. Okay, you write a diary?
Yeah, I write a diary.
Oh, good luck.
And ma'am, I'm working on my second book, so...
My book.
can you give me a few tips?
Whatever she said over the same thing you should follow. But you know, write and don't publish the next year. So every year you are bringing a book, Isha? Huh?
Next.
Hello, my name is Sirtha Kulkarni and I'm from Wadia College. I have had many good teachers, but one person who has taught me a lot, who's my true mentor, is Ms. Geeta Hosmane.
Thank you.
Okay, my question for you is, you are, other than being a great writer, you're also a teacher. So then what does actually teaching mean to you? And what do you consider teaching as?
For me, a teaching is kind of a philanthropy.
Especially for teaching kids.
Teaching is kind of a philanthropy, I really feel. Because when I was a teacher, I used to teach computer science in Bangalore University. Whatever experience I have, I always shared with my students. And sharing, anytime, anything is sharing is philanthropy. No, sharing kind words, sharing your wealth, sharing your knowledge. You know, they're all good things in life. So teaching for me is very sacred. You are sharing your experience. And you know, you should be, all my students really like me for various reasons. Well, number one is I was not very keen on attendance. That could be the reason they're very fond of me. Second thing is, you know, I will never scold students. I never did that with the students, you know, because, well, you know, it is old system thinking the teacher knows everything, students do not know. Actually, today, there is no difference between you and me. Both of us have same knowledge. I have more experience. That's why the hair is gray. So, and I have more patience. So today, students are very bright, and it requires little more patience to teach. And third thing is, you know, you should always encourage students, you know, if they have new ideas, oh, you don't understand what you have seen in life. Don't talk like that, you know. Always looking down upon next generation, I never like. Actually, I feel we can learn a lot from the next generation. So I used to encourage, tell me what are the new things you have seen, what are the new movie you have seen, all those new things I can learn from them. So for me, teaching means a kind of philanthropy. Whatever you have, knowledge, you must share. And don't scold students, don't make them inferior. And, you know, when they make mistake, you should, I used to tell my students, whenever they make a mistake, so what? People who walk, they only fall. So get up again and walk. Making a mistake is not end of life. Life is full of mistakes. But don't make the same mistake again, that's all.
Hello, my name is Kajol Rinwal, and I'm from Symbiosis College. So I have this doubt that, what do you have to say about writer's block? Sometimes you want to say so much, but the words won't come out. So, what do you have to say about
it? Are you a writer? Have you written anytime, anything?
I write.
Because only people know who write, they know the block. Yes, we do get a writer's block. We do get a writer's block. For example, if any serious novel I write, and then I will get a block. I will not be able to write anything for the next 6 or 9 months or something. I will not be able to write because the ideas are still in your mind. It is not worn out. It's not flushed out. So if you write anything at that time, then you write the repetitive will happen. So what I do when I write a novel, I'll just 6-8 months I will not do. Like, you know, if somebody the Shetkari here, they will understand. If you have a sugar cane, every 3 years after sugar cane, 1 year you should not grow anything. Similarly, when you it is not for the column. For novel, I do that. 6 to 8 months, next 9 months, I will not write anything. I'll just put it blank and I only read at that time and don't even think of writing. After 9 months, again, I'm back into action, thinking about what is the new idea, what can I write, what will I do. I mean, I will be thinking on those things, but 6 to 9 months, I don't do. Thanks.
Hello, ma'am. My name is Vihan.
Yeah, it was the first time. Congratulations. All I thought always girls are asking, charo taraf gopiya, beach mein kanaiya.
Ma'am, I'm from Vidya Valley, and my class teacher this year is Fidos, ma'am. Even I have written a book recently, and I would like to give it to you.
Okay, okay. It looks we have a lot more. Come back. I'm very happy. Children are writing. I started 29. They started at 9. So I'm very happy. Yeah, we finish. If anybody wants to give books, please come and
anybody
finish.
Anybody else who has written a book?
And they want to give
and who
me.
Wants to give.
And they want to give me. They don't have to give me. If they want to finish it, because.
Okay, now I open it for others also.
Okay, I'm Meera Boparikar and I was a KG teacher. I retired from my teaching profession. I'm into the wildlife. And recently I wrote a book on wildlife, trek and trail. So while writing the book, I passed, done my education in convent school. But still my family member, my elder brother said, you should get the editing done of the book. So what is your opinion regarding that?
Please sit down. I do not know the contents of your book, so I will not be able to tell. But please sit down. And my book editing, I know how I will do. I will write a book and then 1 or 2 months, I will, it's like a just, you know, I will not bother about the books. I'll keep it inside.
You think editing is important?
Oh, yes. Then I call a professional editor in my case. I call a professional editor because, I don't edit my own books because you make the same mistakes. So I call professional editor and give the book. And I get it edited because editing is, okay, 5 minutes left, okay. Yes. Editing is part of, okay. Now is anyone, anybody's?
There's a girl there.
Yeah, yeah, please.
Hi, ma'am. My name is Anusha. I'm from the Orchid School. Huh. And my teacher's name is Purnimati. Huh. So my question for you is, as a writer, do you feel that the attitude towards people, like as a human being, is really important for your writing skill to be?
No, attitude is different. Please sit down. Yeah. Writing is different. Attitude is the way you want to look at life. That is called attitude towards life. Writing is what you believe. You want to pen it down so that you feel that is right. Every writer feels he or she is right. Because that's then only they can write it. Nothing to do with attitude. I can have any attitude and still I can write. You may not read, that's a different story.
I'm Shreyasi Rao from the Orchid School, and my teacher is Purnamadi. I wanted to ask you, your stories are full of morals, and why do they play such an integral part in your writing?
Please sit down. Actually in real life, it's a very philosophical question. In real life, you don't have to tell lie. You don't have to tell truth. You don't have to be honest. You don't have to do all those things. But that society will not exist. You know, please remember, to have a good family, to good society, good state and good country, they are subset of each other anyway. You require a fundamental foundation. The foundation between people, between you and me, I'm an individual, I'm an island. You are an individual, you are an island. It is true, you, the family members, everybody is an island. The best way to connect two islands is always a bridge. And the foundation for the bridge is honesty, care for others, telling truth, be open. These are the time immemorial values. It was there in Alexander's time. It was there in Harappan's time. It was there much before in Mesopotamian time or in Egyptian time. These fundamental values remain same, independent of language, caste, country, wherever human beings are there. These are the fundamental values or the foundation stones of connecting to bridge. And that's what I write in my book, that please remember, without that also you can live, but not for a long time. People don't trust you. You won't have happy life. You don't have contented life. Ultimate aim in life is not how many awards you have collected, how many cars you own, how much money you have. None of them are ultimately, they bring you happiness. What brings you happiness is content within ourselves. To have the content within ourselves, you have to have these values. When you go to examination, you should have your hall ticket, your pen, then your watch. These are a few equipments you require, and of course knowledge in your brain. You go to the examination hall. Similarly, to be contented in life, you require all these values, then you feel nice about yourself and always you are happy. A happy person only can give happiness to others. A sad person, a sarcastic person, a person who makes comments, okay, time up. Okay, cannot give anything, anybody. Thank you very much, Punekers, coming here. I enjoyed my session as well. Thank you very much.